God's design. They call me Jesus. He came to love. He went for me. He bled and died to buy. Because he lives.
So, a little bit about our speaker. As you remember, Barry invited the Gideons to come and speak a while ago. And then I was contacted by a gentleman named Mike Davis. So, being the controlling cop that I am, I said, well, I need to see you. Can you come visit me? And I will check you out. And so we talked, and I interrogated, and I said, okay, I'll let you talk. So then I said, here are my requirements. You will preach the gospel, you will read from the Bible, and you can pair it with testimony and tell us what Gideon is looking for and support and in people. And so he says, okay, that sounds great. So then he calls me he sent me a couple of videos that he was going to use for his presentation, and then he calls me on Thursday and he says, I have the vid and I can't be there. The vid, that's what I called COVID. And so he says, but a much better speaker than me lives in Yuba City. And I said, neat, but that only leaves me 2 days to vet this guy. And he says, okay, here's his number. He's over at Geyser Pets. And I said, okay. And he says, his name is John Geyser. Well, okay. I've been into Geyser Pets many a time. So I called John on Thursday, right after I got off the phone with Mike. And I was put on hold for a half an hour. And I said, this is a busy man. So on Friday, I didn't call. Susanna and I loaded up in the truck and we drove down there. And we met, I walk up and there's this gentleman who is unloading a pallet out front, doing the work, and he's got his hands dirty. And I said, are you John? He says, I am. So then I met John, and I feel comfortable exposing you guys to him. I think he's going to do a great job. You ready, John? And do you want a mic or do you want a headset? Okay. You can move the chair, you can sit in the chair. I like it because it swivels. Okay.
Well, good morning, church. Welcome, thank you. That's a good one. So how many of you have heard about the Gideons, but you pretty much just know us from our motel and hotel Bibles? Well, that is what we are most famous for, but it's not all that we do. Several years ago, in a little town in Indiana, probably a town the size of Gridley, early in the morning, a lady walked into the motel lobby. The clerk working there that day remembers her, noticed her, because she had taken one of our Bibles from her room, which we encourage, and she had our Bible in one hand, and she had a gun in the other. I've never worked in a motel or hotel before, but I guess you would notice that. And so she explained to the clerk working there, she says, I checked into this motel last night fully intending to kill myself, but I found God's word instead. And as I started to read it, I lost my desire to kill myself. So, yes. So she says, I'll be leaving now, and I'll be taking this Bible with me. And being a wise guy, if I had worked there myself, I would have said, yes, ma'am, would you like this lovely lamp, too, to go with it? And she said, but I'm leaving the gun. So she took the Bible and left the gun. And as far as I know, she's still alive and well. Now, there's a backstory to this story. The backstory is, for several years, the Gideons in this little town were trying to put our Bibles into those rooms. Every 6 months, that's what we go to buy motels and hotels. Every 6 months, they check in with the lady owner, visit her in her office, and ask for permission. And every time, she said no. In fact, the last time they went, she said no, and you're trespassing, meaning I'm going to call the cops on you if you don't get out of here. So they left, but before they completely left the property, which they always did, they gathered together in the parking lot and prayed about it. Well, it looks like we were at a standstill. Several months passed, and one of the Gideons involved with that, who lived out of town, had to come into town to do some errands. And before he left home, he felt God telling him, put 30 of these Bibles in your trunk. He didn't hear an audible voice. He just felt God wanted him to do that. So he did. He goes into town. He runs his errands. Nothing happened. He's leaving town. Nothing's happening. So he prays. I don't know why we wait to the end to pray. When we exhaust our own strength or wisdom or something, then we say, okay, God, all right, I get it. So he prayed what to do. And when he was done with his prayer, he looked up and he saw the motel sign on the horizon just down the street. He goes, okay, I get it. So he stops in again to check in with this lady. And she looks at him and says, okay, you just don't give up, do you? No, ma'am, I'm sorry, I just thought God wanted me to one more time to check in with you. She says, okay, how about this? You can put these Bibles in my motel, but you got to do every room. You can't do half the rooms or three quarters of the room. You have to do all the rooms. Yes, ma'am, we'll do all the rooms. How many rooms do you have? She says, 30. Right, you guessed it. So he puts it in. And there's a third part to this story. That's why I like it. It's a sandwich, story sandwich or something. The third part is we found out sometime later that the woman that owned the motel and the woman that almost killed herself, but God's word stopped her, are sisters. So now you know the rest of the story. Can I use that line? He's gone. He's gone on glory now. Ah, right. I'm stealing it. So it is only 8% of what we do. There's 55,000 motels and hotels in America, not rooms, buildings. Most of them still take our Bibles, though it's getting increasingly harder. But that's just 8% of what we do. We also, among many other things, we go to jails and prisons. You'd be surprised how open people are to the gospel when they've tried it their way, and now they're in solitary confinement. They're more open to it. In fact, I'm getting old. I got to get my glasses. Let me read. Okay, good for you. It's relative. That's what he asked. It says, my husband and I were career criminals, safe crackers, and bank robbers. I was on the FBI's most wanted list and the target of a mafia contract. I was proficient with all kinds of guns, including a .357 Magnum. I once placed a shotgun in the face of a bank teller during a robbery. And I must say, if I had a wife like that, our son would have grown up and got better grades. he would have listened to mom. Finally, I was arrested, convicted of armed robbery, and thrown in jail in Birmingham, Alabama, with a 21-year sentence. And later, I ended up in solitary confinement. And in solitary confinement, she says, I found a black Gideon Bible there and shoved it under my mattress. One day, I took it out and began reading. I was drawn to a verse in Ezekiel chapter 36. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh. Quietly, on the floor in my cell that night, I surrendered my life to the Lord. God had saved me. I saw the problems of other prisoners, particularly the loneliness of separation from their families, and now I am blessed that God also used me as his instrument to begin the Angel Tree ministry, which you probably have heard of, and that's the testimony of Mary K. Beard, and her testimony, her ministry now is in all 50 states and 40-something other countries. But also, one more prison testimony while I'm on a roll here. It says, maximum security prisons have been my home now for almost 20 years. I deserve my sentence of 365 years behind bars. That's a lot. I destroyed the lives of others and threw away my own life. I deserve death. While I was confined to the infamous Attica prison, I almost died when a prisoner slit my throat with a razor. And one cold winter's night, I was walking in the prison yard. Another inmate walked up to me, introduced himself, and boldly told me that Jesus Christ loved me and had a plan for my life. I noticed he had a big smile on his face and a little Bible in his hands, which was a great combination. I laughed and told him there's no way God could love me. I was too evil. We began to walk together, and he would read portions of the New Testament. Within a few weeks, he gave me a small Gideon New Testament with Psalm and Proverbs. I took that little Bible and began to read it. I'd never before read the Bible. The words were so beautiful. One night, alone in my cell, I was looking at Psalm 34. That's the one that says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. And the words pierced my soul. I felt compelled to get down on my knees and pour out my heart to God. I asked him to forgive me for all I had done. That was a moment I was born again. It was the turning point in my life.
Now, 30 more years have gone by. Through God's grace, I'm still walking with Jesus every day. I serve God in the prison I am in. The evil son of Sam has even been given a new name, Son of Hope. And those of you my age and older remember back in December 75 through August of 77, he killed and wounded many people. He just randomly went out at night in the streets of New York City shooting people. And it was a parking ticket that tripped him up, and that's how they caught him. So, guys, if you're going to do some crimes, don't get parking tickets. That's not the main lesson, though. And so 200 New York City police detectives were on his case at one time before they found him. So when you think of somebody about as evil as you can get, because you heard voices in his head and such, God, it's just amazing what he can do and how he can turn people around. But anyway, not to give you all the testimonies, of course, we'd be here till midnight, but we also go besides motel hotels, besides jails and prisons, we go to junior high schools, colleges and universities. In fact, about 80% of the Bibles we give away are to young people. And they say, why do you go to young people so much? Their hearts are soft. We have greater success with them than any other age group. We go to county fairs, state fairs, military bases and recruitment centers, crisis pregnancy centers, convalescent homes, veterinary offices, domestic violence shelters, Bridal Hospital in Marysville. You'll find our Bibles in English and Spanish in the chapel. And when moms have babies, they give them a gift basket, and one of our New Testaments is inside the little gift basket for the mom. There's over 70 venues in all that we go to. And as far as I know, we're the first or second biggest distributor of God's Word on the planet. And of course, we do one-on-one Bible distribution, too. In fact, a good Gideon always carries a little New Testament around with him, usually in his pocket or somewhere, and women in their purse. I know a Gideon and his wife down in Sacramento. Every time they go out to eat, they pray. Every time they pray, they ask the waiter or the waitress, is there anything we can pray for you? You'd be surprised. They've only been turned down once in like 300 or 400 times. People who aren't even Christians think, well, maybe the Christian God is real. Maybe he exists. Maybe he will hear your prayers. Yes, I have a health problem or a relationship problem or something. So they always pray with their help. And then before they leave, and along with the tip, they give them a little New Testament. Well, they did that at their favorite restaurant with a waitress there. And off they went. Several weeks go by. They come back to the same restaurant. They get the same waitress. Probably not a coincidence. And they ask her how she's doing. She goes, I'm a new creation of Christ. You know, what? You're saying? What happened? She says, remember last time you were here, you gave me a Bible. I took it. And I said, well, maybe I'll read it if I get around to it. So she puts it in her glove box. She drives home. She gets in a terrible accident. And she was only received minor injuries, but her car was totaled, and she couldn't get out. So while she's waiting, I don't know how many minutes for the fire department to get there with the jaws of life, you know, to open up a hole for her to get out. She says, well, I might as well do something with my time. So she starts to read the Bible that she had. And that's all it took to save her. So I love this stuff, and I love giving away. We give away tens of millions a year, 2.5 billion Bibles we've given away since our founding in 1899. But you know, that's misleading. I tell people, it looks like we're in the Bible distributing business, but we're not. We're in the soul winning business. We give away Bibles because it works. Remember Hebrews 4:12, the word is alive and active. In Matthew 24:35, heaven and earth will pass away, but God's word never will. This little Bible, these that you see here, that I've got here and in my briefcase, it looks like it's paper and ink and glue, and it is. But it's the only book I know of that was written by God himself. It's also, someone once said, it's the only book that when you read it, the author shows up, you know, which is kind of cool. So anyway, let me give you a couple more real quick, and then we'll show a little video. Dr. David Koo, K-O-O, he entered the South Korean Army, received the Gideon New Testament. He put it on the shelf for a few years. And you know, I like how the Bible refers to itself as a seed. Because seeds can sit around for a while before they germinate. And so it sat there on his shelf for years, and one day he just got curious. And he read it, and he got saved. He became a pastor and president of New Life School in Cambodia. And it's a little different there in Cambodia. It's K through university. Imagine that, going to high school or a college class, and there's little kids running around, which sounds kind of cool. They survey the students as they enter the school, whatever age that is. 2% of them are Christians as they enter. They survey them again as they graduate. 70% are Christians when they graduate. So literally, one little bitty $1.50 New Testament has resulted in several thousand young people finding Christ. Or Heriberto Tico, He lived in the Philippines. He received a Gideon New Testament at school when he was a child and received Christ shortly thereafter. He grew up and became a pastor. He got married, had five sons. They became pastors. His five sons got married, had 15 grandsons. Also, there's two nephews in there somewhere. They're all pastors. And last time I checked, that family, Heriberto himself and his family, have planted over 600 churches in the Philippines. And it all started with one itty-bitty little New Testament. And so if we're ready, maybe for the video, we'll check that out and see what it is.
I got involved in drugs while I was in dental school, thinking that I could do both, be a graduate student by day and doing drugs and partying. Well, this whole time, my parents, they had been a Christian for several years now and just had really grown in their faith. My parents knew the only way they would be able to see me, since I wanted nothing to do with them. They actually flew down to Atlanta one time, and after the second day, I kicked them out. But my dad, he wanted to give me something, and it was his very first Bible, and he left it on my kitchen counter. But as soon as they left, I took his Bible and I threw it in the trash can. My mom prayed that God would do whatever it takes to bring this prodigal son to the Father. Well, this miracle, this answer to prayer came one day with a bang on my door. I opened up my door, and on my front doorstep were 12 federal drug enforcement agents, Atlanta police, and two big German Shepherd dogs. I just received a large shipment of drugs, and they confiscated all my money and my drugs, and I was charged with a street value equivalent of 9.1 tons of marijuana. I was walking around the cell block, and I passed by this garbage can, and as I looked at that garbage can, I felt like I was looking at my own life. And I was about to pass by that garbage can, but something on top of the trash caught my eye. I bent over, and I picked it up, and it was a Gideon's New Testament. I took that New Testament back to my cell, and for the very first time, I opened up that New Testament and I read through the entire Gospel of Mark. And as I know today, what we have in our Bibles is not just ink on paper, but what we have in our Bibles is the very breath of God. And it's living and powerful and sharper than any double-edged sword. And as I began to read God's Word, it began to penetrate me. And it began to cut through my stubborn, hard heart. He revealed his plan for my life, and he called me in full-time ministry while I was in prison. So the greatest miracle of this whole story is that actually Moody accepted me. I was released from prison in July of 2001, and I started the very next month. I'm teaching now back at Moody in the Bible department, so I tell people I went from prisoner to professor. Only God brought me back.
Oh, and I forgot to show you guys this old Gideon Bible that I have here. It's off the Queen Mary cruise ship, because we go to cruise ships too. Well, they retired it and gave it back to us, but so I keep it as a kind of memento. Anyway, if you are a Christian, and I pray everybody here is, or shortly will be, you've been given a great gift. It's called salvation. You've also been given a great commission, and that is to tell other people about your salvation. But people say to me all the time, they go, John, I'm shy. No, how can I do that? And I say, in Mark 5:19, after Jesus healed a man with an evil spirit, he told the man, go home to your own people and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you. The man didn't need to preach a powerful sermon or attend seminary, which are both fine. All he needed to do was share his story. Everybody saved has a story to share. And don't belittle your actions. To people, if they know you're a Christian, don't get paranoid, but they may watch you. And they, do you tell dirty jokes? Do you cuss? Are you kind and gentle to people? Are you generous? Are you hardworking? It shows, you know, and it speaks well of your salvation in Christ. I'm going to make it a little easier on you guys. You say, again, John, I'm still shy, and can I help you guys fulfill the Great Commission? Yes, we're here to help each other in any way we can. First of all, you guys can pray for us. Absolutely. I know people throw that four-letter word out just too casually. Prayer is powerful. Oh, good, good. I got good folks here. We have these little brochures that call to be a friend of the Gideons. You don't have to join us officially to become a friend of the Gideons. And if you subscribe there, you'll fill out the form, mail it in. We'll send you, we have a quarterly newsletter with some great testimonies and things you can pray for and things online you can pray for, and you can be a part of us. Now, you're not officially a Gideon, so I can't show you the secret handshake, but it's still a very, very cool thing. And a reason I mentioned prayer was a British pastor, Samuel Chadwick, you can Google him later if you want. He said, Satan dreads nothing but prayer. His one concern is to keep saints from praying. He fears nothing from prayerless studies, prayerless work, prayerless religion. He laughs at our tools and he mocks our wisdom, but he trembles when we pray. So I thought that's a pretty good quote. Anyway, so we've got that. Also, if you'd like to give to us, we've got little flyers, brochures out there. There's Hal. I hired him this morning. He works for a nickel an hour. Good man. And there's an envelope in there. If you didn't bring a check or cash or something, you can send it in later. Most of the money that the Gideons raised in here in Northern California, it's from us. But boy, we need all the help we can. There is just, we can't print Bibles fast enough. Particularly in third world countries, they will give away all that we can give them and then some. So that's a good thing. We also have these Bible app cards. I think they're magic. I brought a couple hundred of them. You can download the whole Bible on your phone. 1,700 languages. Maybe English isn't your first choice. Maybe you want to learn Swahili. Well, there you go. There's Swahili right there. And then we have these life books, and I'm looking at the young people in the front here. The life books is it's either the Book of John or the Book of Mark. They're free. You go to thelifebook.com and you order them in boxes of 100, and you give them away to other high school kids in high school. And in Yuba City and Marysville last year, the high school kids gave 4,900 of these away to their fellow students on there. Right, because when we go, we as Gideons go, like a couple weeks ago, we were at Marysville High School. We have to stand on the public sidewalk. We're not allowed on campus. So we only reach like 10, 15% of the kids. But the kids can go on campus and nobody can stop them, you know, because that's where they go to school. So that's all good. And finally, I just want to say something that you want to do something. Someone, I don't know who quoted this, says, while it is true that not every person has a spiritual gift of evangelism, we are all called to do the work of the evangelist. And I started thinking about that, and I think there is benefit in getting older. We were talking about that. No, not the aches and pains, but just your perspective on life. And I realize that all of us are busy. And I try to add in my mind how many decisions we make in an average day. And I came up with hundreds, and then I changed my mind. I think it's thousands. I think I drove 40 minutes from where I live up in the hills down here. I probably made hundreds of decisions in that 40-minute drive. How to turn, check my mirrors, when to brake, when to accelerate. And we make all these decisions. And some of them aren't that important, you know, what socks to put on in the morning. Some are important, like who to marry, how to raise children, and so forth. And that's all fine, but we get so busy in just with life, are we worried about the eternal life of our fellow men and women around us? And so you really have to prioritize things, right? You have to remember, besides making all these little decisions, think about the big decisions. And of course, I would tell someone who's not saved, I said, the biggest decision you'll ever make, infinitely bigger than all the other decisions you ever made your whole life, is what are you going to do with Jesus? Are you going to accept him as Lord and Savior and worship and love him, or are you going to reject him? That's your only two choices, and that will last for eternity. So I tell him, I said, number one, choice number one, take that one. That's the where to go. Because Hebrews 9:27 says, just as man is destined to die once, and after that to face judgment. That's kind of a serious thing. And when I think, because I am getting older, and I realize there's more years behind me than ahead of me, I start spending more time, I hope, working for Christ. And so that's why I'm very active with the Gideons, hours a week. I do something with the Gideons. And then at work, I started giving out Bibles at work. You'd be surprised how many of my Christian friends came up to me. I own the property. I own the building. I pay taxes on it, right? This is still America. But people come up to me and say, does the government know you're giving away Bibles? I don't know, and I don't care. Does the government want some Bibles? You know? Or give them some. So I don't know how many, we give away about 3,000 a year there in my pet store. And it was because of the Gideons I got inspired to do this. Like I said, man, this is fun.
And so I give away whatever. And I buy with good Bibles on sale, good translations. And I have helpers. People say, well, how can you give away thousands a year? I have one lady rides the bus around Yuba City, Marysville. I have a car. I have a truck. I don't never ride the bus. Well, she's poor. She rides the bus. Well, she comes in every few weeks, gets a dozen Bibles, sits down next to people on the bus, engages them in conversation, hands them a Bible. So she's not really working for me. She's yes. And so that works out well. And I've been, the newspaper's done articles on me in my business a couple times, not because of the pets, because I give out Bibles. And I did, oh, I did bring it. That's okay. But I'll be showing off. I showed you. The people that own the rights to the NIV, and it's now called Church Source, I think, the company. If you check out the 2004 annual catalog, I'm on the cover. Because I kept buying thousands of Bibles from them at a time. And they said, well, what kind of ministry is this? Or what church do you pastor? I don't church. I pastor a church. I have a pet store. And all my hamsters are saved. Yes. You can't get that at PetSmart or Petco. No. And so they said, we want to do an article. And you said, okay, what the heck, I'll do that. And when I'm really old in the nursing home one day, I'll just look through my memories, you know, on that. So anyway, I don't know, in all seriousness, I know I joke too much. I don't know the future other than what's recorded in Scripture. But I do know there's still time now to get the word out, to reach people, to influence people, to help people, to give them a Bible, to invite them to church, to pick them up if they don't have a car and drive them here and back home again, whatever. And so now that I realize that, you know, life is short. Sorry to tell you young people that, but it really is short. So redeem the time. Redeem every day and do all you can to serve the Lord every day. You will not regret it. And I don't know what kind of gifts God has in plan for us, but he does say you can't even imagine what I've got in store for you. And I've got a pretty good imagination. So if it's better than that, I'm glad I signed up. Well, thank you, everybody. Thank you for listening. You're a good audience.
John, did you ever find your python that you let out?
Oh, yes.
That's a little one. So, I thought that we could do a special offering, and we can give the Gideons a gift. Like he said, $1.50 for the small Bibles, and it also includes Psalms in there, right? Psalms, Proverbs, and so we got a couple dozen in the back to give away, and again, giving away costs money, but if we could help them out, they would love it. Can you walk that around? I brought cash just because I knew you were coming. The or tehe. great idea. And what was your name, sir? Oh, he can't hear. He's like me. Ray, can you come up and we're gonna pray for you and John? Father God Almighty, Lord, I just give thanks and praise. Lord, I thank you that John was courageous enough to come out and speak to us, Lord. And what a wonderful mouth for the Lord that you have given him, Lord, and a heart. Lord, I thank you for the Gideons. Man, what a ministry is to hand out your word. Lord, I ask that you would continue to bless them, continue to allow other people to let them onto their property to hand out Bibles, and that each Bible would find somebody in need. find somebody who is lost and seeking, and not just that they find it, but that they open it and read it. Lord, and we ask that your Holy Spirit would give them that understanding that would show them that the Word is the breath of God, that it is God, because God is the Word, and the Word is God. Lord, we just we thank you for this day. I thank you for this opportunity. We have ears. May we hear what we were told, and bless us, Lord. Give us courage to follow you, to seek you, to understand. In Jesus' name, amen.